I grew up in a little town with the name of Stanton, Texas. It's out in West Texas, approximately halfway between Fort Worth and El Paso. But that's where I grew up. It was Depression days.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Oh, very heavily.
How so?
Well, my father owned a dairy. And when the Depression hit, his milk went to naught. He couldn't sell it. We were selling milk for 7 cents a quart, a nickel a quart for buttermilk. And I would hitch up this old horse to an old cart and deliver it around this little town, the name of Stanton, Texas. And then they drove my daddy into bankruptcy. And the difference in voluntary and involuntary bankruptcy, his was not voluntary. He didn't volunteer, but he was driven into bankruptcy. But he had a job as a mail carrier, so that's what saved our lives through the Depression. But I just grew up there and went to high school, and I went to a business college in Fort Worth, Texas. And I'd been in this college a while, and I'd spent more time across the street in the pool hall than I did in school. But so then I decided to go to work for a roofing company, a manufacturer. Well, I worked in a butcher shop first, and that was 75 hours a week for $18. So I decided that was not for me, and I got a friend of mine worked for this roofing manufacturer, and he got me into that. Got me a job at $15 a week for only 40 hours, so that was better. Then when the war broke out December 7th, I was a prime age. I was 21 years old. And June, January then, I just went down and joined the Army.
Do you remember hearing about Pearl Harbor and how it impacted you?
Absolutely.
Where were you?
Well, I was surviving a hangover in Mineral Wells, Texas. My two roommates and I had been courting these girls in Mineral Wells, and we had rented a car on Saturday night to go to Mineral Wells to see them. And woke up the next day, and whenever, I think it was around noon or so, when this came on the car radio, we were just surviving the last night's festivities, and we heard it on the car radio in Mineral Wells, Texas.
Did you know that it was going to affect you?
Well, yes, I knew it was going to affect me because there was a draft in those days, and I was, as I say, I just turned 21, so I'm a ripe age for the draft. But I never had to register for the draft because if I'd been 21 before July 1st of 1941, then I would have had to register. But since I was 21 July 22nd, 1941, I didn't have to register until the next draft was in February 1942. And I joined the Army before then. Since I didn't have a very good education, I decided that I wanted to be in armament school. So I went to Denver, Colorado. That's where they sent me, the armament school. And I'd been there a little while, and there again, my age affected me. They asked me that I'd like to be in the Flying Sergeants program. And I said yes, and if you had an IQ of 110 or more, which mine was 119, and your age is 22 or so at the maximum, and I was 21, so they sent me to this Flying Sergeant school.
And what was that?
I was in Muskogee, Oklahoma, and it was actually the same program that all pilots took at that time. Whatever kind of plane you were going to fly, all pilots went to these schools. Flying Sergeant, if you graduated as a Flying Sergeant, you graduated as a Staff Sergeant, not as an officer. They a little later junked the program, and they had them all graduate as commissioned officers. Well, I washed out of that because of lack of progress, they said. No specific, just lack of progress. And then I went into glider pilot school. And I had gone through two phases of that with flying colors because of my previous flying experience. And they closed that down because they had too many people. So they said, try whatever you want to, you put down what you want to do. And so I asked for a reinstatement in pilot training for the OCS, or Bombardier School. Well, the Army always got the third one. So they sent me to Bombardier School.
Should have put pilot as number three.
if I'd put a number, I don't think they would have reinstated me. But anyway, when I graduated from Bombardier School in Roswell, New Mexico, that was October 2nd, 1943, they sent me to Salt Lake City, Utah. And there, you was assigned other crew members. And I was assigned to a crew of officers. It was four officers, the pilot, co-pilot, navigator, bombardier, and then six enlisted men. And this was to become a crew of a B-17. So that's what happened in Salt Lake City. They assigned me to this crew. I met the crew member. In fact, we had reunions up until they all died. And we went to war as a crew. But we sent us from Salt Lake City to Alexandria, Louisiana, and then to Grand Island, Nebraska, and overseas.
When do you remember what your first impression of that B-17 was? Because in those days, that was a big plane.
Oh, yes, I liked it very much. And of course, in Bombardier School, I had seen photographs of it, and so I was familiar not with the plane itself, but what it looked like. Because I had flown a twin-engine aircraft in Bombardier School. So there I knew that the same bomb sight is going to be in that B-17 was in that twin-engine aircraft. So my office was going to be the same, whatever kind of airplane I was in.
During your training period, were there any events or things that happened that kind of stand out in your mind?
Well, I don't, you mean as a crew?
Either individual training or your training as a crew. When you look back on that training period, was there things that stood out in your mind?
Oh, yes. Well, in the wonder part of the joining us together as a crew, these four officers, pilot, co-pilot, navigator, bombardier, if we went down to the flight line of a morning to have training, and they'd said, no training today, the weather won't permit, we all four went to the bar right then. We were very congenial in that regard. We all liked to have a drink, and so that stuck in my mind. And then when we were flying, as further training, we were flying from Grand Island, Nebraska to Presque Isle, Maine. And somewhere over the state of New York, where the pilot called up and said, pilot to navigator, where are we? And it was silence, and this navigator said, well, gentlemen, according to my calculations, we should remove our hats because we're in St. Patrick's Cathedral, New York City. Pilot said a few choice words about the navigator's ancestors and requested again a more specific where we are. You know, he told him where we were. And we landed in Presque Isle, Maine.
You've reminded me of a question, and that is, you know, with all those different guys on that, 10 guys on a plane, all with different backgrounds and different ranks, enlisted and officers. What was the relationship like? Was it real GI? Was it, you know?
I think the relationship was wonderful. We all liked each other. The officers all liked each other, and the officers and enlisted men got along real well. And these enlisted men, they were real military when we were working. They were kind of casual when we were not working. We were ferrying a brand new B-17. And that was one way they'd get the crew and the new B-17 across the ocean.
Do you remember what month and year that was you were heading over?
Yes, that was about, I believe it was March 1944. It was February or March 1944, and we flew to Presque Isle, Maine, and weathered in there for two or three days, and we flew from there to Gander Bay, Newfoundland, and weathered in there for two or three days. And finally, we took off, and we flew from Gander Bay, Newfoundland, to Prestwick, Scotland, nonstop, overnight. And there then, when we got to Prestwick, Scotland, we were assigned to a pool, and they drew the from this pool to send you to the various bomb groups. And that's how we got to 390th Bomb Group. Our crew, they took our new airplane away from us when we got to Prestwick. But we then went to 390th Bomb Group at Framlingham.
Do you remember what your impression was of the base and what it was like to live on a base like that?
Oh, you're scared of, because you're in a new environment. You've never been here before, and these people are all shot to hell and got some older airplanes out there. Yeah, you're scared.
Were you assigned to like a Quonset hut?
Yes, we have, in fact, four officers lived in a Quonset hut. They had eight officers in a Quonset hut, two crews of officers. And enlisted men lived in a different area, in a different Quonset hut.
What did the base look like? I mean, was this just a little place, or was it?
Well, it's not too small, but it's not too large, but it's widely dispersed. In other words, 568 Squadron, and way over there is 569, way out here is a 570, way out here is a 571st. We know each other, but they're dispersed for a reason, to keep the Germans from bombing them, strafing them. When I became a Squadron Bombardier, my duties would be in the morning, and then I'd be through until later in the day. And I hated powdered eggs. That's all we ever got was powdered eggs, except the flying crews got eggs, but we didn't, the rest of us. So I had a bicycle. I was assigned a bicycle. And somebody told me that a farmer down the road there, I think it was 5 miles, but it probably was only two or three, would sell eggs. And he'd sell those eggs for $1 a dozen. Now that's a lot of money in those days. But I'd pedal my bicycle down, I'd buy those eggs and take them back to my barracks in my Quonset hut and hide them underneath my bed and take them up to the kitchen, two at a time. And they'd fry them for me at the mess hall. One morning, I can remember specifically, these young recruits, I had been one of those before, but they just new replacements, just came on the base. And they saw me eating, they said, "Oh boy, eggs." And this guy who was serving a table said, "No, he brought them with him." And they got their powdered eggs. But I'd pedal down there. Every time I'd run out of eggs, I'd pedal my bicycle down there and pay $1 a dozen for eggs. The first mission, I've forgotten exactly what our Augsburg was our destination. We went there and got so far, and I believe they said something, they scrubbed the mission for some reason. But we had entered heavy flak, heavy anti-aircraft fire. And when we got back, we counted 87 holes of entry on that shrapnel that came with that airplane. But not a single guy got a scratch.
Who was your pilot?
My pilot's name was Doc Burton S. Doc Spring, S-P-R-I-N-G.
And did you use, how many missions did you fly?
Well, I ended up flying 22, but I got myself assigned to squadron staff. I was a squadron bombardier, so then I didn't fly as much.
And those 22 missions, did you generally fly one plane, or was there a whole series of planes?
We flew different planes. At first, our crew was assigned to a specific airplane. Well, then my pilot had grandiose ideas, and we became what they call a lead crew, and we had training as a lead crew. So then we didn't fly as often, except in training, and we didn't have specific airplane anymore.
Tell us what a lead crew did.
Well, the lead crew would be the one out in front of the mission. All the others would be following this lead crew. The lead crew would have a command pilot, like Pennebaker was a command pilot. And he would be sitting there. They would lead the mission. The navigator did the navigating. All the others, the bombardiers like myself, if I was in the lead crew, then I did the sighting of my bomb sight. If I was in a wing crew, I just dropped my bombs when the others did. And we just went along with wherever the others went.
Seems like there would be more pressure on you as a bombardier if you're in the lead.
It is, a lot more pressure.
Because if you make a mistake, everybody makes a mistake.
You make a mistake, everybody does, that's true. the first mission I led, I made a mistake. We all made mistakes.
What mistake?
Sir, that was going to Leipzig. But it was very heavily defended and a lot of smoke, and I just didn't find the right target.
Was it, what were the difficulties in the job of a bombardier? I mean, as far as trying to find the target, what made the job hard?
Well, that really, it was the hardest part of the job. The bombsight did the rest for you. If you could identify that target and get your sight on it, then you just operate the bombsight. You get two knobs with this hand and two knobs with this hand. These two knobs up here control the rate of closure, and the two knobs down here control the drift. That's all there was to it. You keep us going a straight line and a rate of closure, and if when that bomb sight hits, it hits the target.
Take us through the process then of how would you learn what the target was and how to recognize it?
Well, you went to a briefing 1-2 o'clock in the morning, and they had a big target there, and they pointed out the target and the identifying features. Of course, it never was exactly like they said, but it was the best they knew. They gave you every advantage they could give you. And they gave you photographs and maps that you could study on the way.
Were there, in the 22 missions that you mentioned, were there missions that stood out in your mind?
Well, yes. I don't know that Berlin would always stand out in your mind because it was so heavily defended. And they had 480 some odd guns that they could bring to bear on you when you go over the target. I remember going one day flying over Berlin, and I could see ahead of me this black pall of smoke. What that is anti-aircraft fire. That's not a cloud, that's anti-aircraft fire. And it's so thick that the airplanes ahead of you went through it and you couldn't even see them. And I got to go through that. You think that don't scare you? That scares the heck out of you.
What, and that's a good point, what sustains you? How do you handle that kind of fear?
Well, I don't know, you just do the best you can. I mean, there's a lot of prayers, I'm sure, by everybody. But you're naturally going to be scared. I was sitting there one day and 6 bullets went through the bottom and out the top about that far behind my back. And that will scare you. And then I was sitting there one day when we were flying to Munich, and one came in here and penetrated, and here and penetrated, and here and penetrated. I had on a rubber oxygen mask, and this piece of metal about that long penetrated. I found it by licking it with my tongue.
So it had just gone through the mask, but not
It didn't go in through the mouth. It went at the mouth, but it didn't. It stopped in there. But this one penetrated and had to be cut out. I still got the piece of metal. It was cut out of my arm. And this one, I never did find a piece of metal. They took it out too. I never did find it.
Did you or the aircraft have other close calls like that?
Well, yes. We had on over half of the missions that I flew, I had flak in the nose of the airplane with me. I mean, shrapnel would go somewhere in that. I'm sitting up here one day looking like that, and I'd raise my head back because a hole appeared about that big around in front of my nose, and that'll make you tilt your head back.
Was there any sense of, with those close calls of fate, how, it seemed to smile on some but not on others, and, did you have any sense of when your time's up, it's up, or anything like that, or superstitions, or anything?
Well, no, I didn't have any superstitions, but I guess that I just didn't have any sense. Once it's gone by, I forget it until the next time. And that's what you're kind of calloused, I guess, to that. You lose roommates. I lost 5 sets of roommates while I was over there. But you get kind of callous to it because that happens all the time.
You're talking about the other crews in the Quonset huts,
mm-hmm.
And they were shot down?
Well, I had when I became a squadron bombardier, then it was individuals. But while I was in the Quonset huts, it was crews. So 4 of them would be gone. The day that I got hit, I was looking in the bomb bay of my roommates, the other crew of officers, and their bomb bay was on fire. And they went down, and I found out 4 or 5 years ago that they did get imprisoned and made it out. Until then, I didn't know. I knew they were not there when I got back to when I got back from the hospital. When they took me, when I came down out of the sky, they took me in to put me in a dispensary, and then sent me to a regional hospital for surgery and rehab.
Did you? It's kind of a strange question, but did you like being in the lead position?
Well, yes, I think everybody does. You want to be saying that I did this, I led this mission. Yes, we all like that.
Were there missions that you felt particularly satisfied, successful about?
Yes.
Which, do you remember which
one? One would be in Paris. After the invasion, they
discovered... You're talking about D-Day?
The D-Day. They had fuel tanks in Paris on the banks of the Seine River that we thought the Germans would use for their tanks and other war machines. So they sent us up there, and that was my lead mission. And I was to bomb these tanks right on the Seine River, and I did, and hit them. June
22nd, 1944. Were there others?
Oh, yes, there's others. The only time I ever got to tell a colonel off, they sent us on this day after D-Day, which would have been June the 7th. They sent us down to bomb a railroad bridge in a town, and it was a very hasty briefing, and I didn't even get maps. I didn't even get photographs. And a young man was supposed to lead the mission. And he's having difficulty getting these bombs out of the airplane. So they asked my pilot, could we take over? And I said, yes, we can take over, get these bombs out of here, because those guys were popping at our butts close. So they asked me to take over, and I took it over. And they had told us when we were this brief briefing, it was the first bridge on the edge of town, okay? I synchronized on that first bridge on the edge of town and bombed it. But it was the second bridge. So this colonel said, what'd you do that? I said, by God, because I didn't get briefed right. And he didn't give me any lip either. he knew that I didn't get briefed right. If he had told me it was this next bridge. But they didn't have time. They were in a hurry to get down there because they had heard that the Germans were sending troops by train up from southern France. So we were trying to bomb this bridge so the troops couldn't get across there.
You know, I'm picturing, you know, a lot of different guys, and you were seeing different crews at different points. You were flying
yes.
with different people and all that stuff. And I'm trying to get a sense, you know, if we were doing a movie of all those guys on those planes and everything, and it's like, which guy were you? You know what I mean?
Which guy was yeah. I? I don't know which guy I would have been. If I had my preference, I would have rather have flown with Doc Spring, the guy who had been assigned to in the first place. To me, he was the most skillful and careful pilot I had ever flown with. And I really like flying with him. Some of the others were a little suspect to me. I've always heard there's hot pilots and old pilots, but there's not any old hot pilots.
Did you participate in any of the shuttle runs?
No, I did not.
Did you have a period where there was a countdown in your number of missions?
Yes, after I got wounded, and then I got assigned to Squadron Bombardier, I didn't have as many, didn't fly as often.
How many total missions then did you do?
22.
22, I see.
I got hit on the 20th one. I hit July 13, 1944, I'd remember it well.
Take us through after after the 22nd mission. Was the war over? Was
yes,
it?
The war was over. That was in, I think it was April 1945, and it was Frankfurt, Germany. And that was my last mission, and then the war was over May the 9th, 1945, so just less than a month later. We stayed there in the squadron, at the base, for a few days, and then all of a sudden the base was to be vacated. And because I didn't belong to a crew, mine was separate, and I was sent to a place called Blackpool, England, as a pool of flying back to the United States in a war weary. And I got assigned to a crew that I knew from the base, and we flew a war weary B-24, don't you?
Were you a little hesitant about testing fate by flying back in an...
Oh, yes, in a B-24, you better believe it. The only thing, I just trusted this guy, this pilot that I had known at the base. And he had already flown a B-24 as well as a B-17. So he was a natural. They just took him because he could fly a B-24. And they sent us back, and of course, one of the engines went out over Iceland, and we had to land in Iceland and get some work done on that engine. I still remember this, they had assigned a guy on emergency leave. He was a first sergeant in England. They had assigned him to go with our crew. And we were just standing there waiting for this, the repairs to be over with. And the sun went down the horizon and moved over about 10 miles and came back up. This sergeant and I both stand there, and he looked at me and he said, "Hey, Lieutenant, I'd hate to give a man a 3-day pass up here. The SOB never would come back." It tickled me. But we got that engine repaired, and then we flew on to Goose Bay, Labrador, and back into Bradley Field, Connecticut.
What did it feel like to get home?
Ooh, that was the most wonderful thing ever happened. We still live in the greatest country in the world.
With all the experience that you had, you know, had over there in Europe, and then you came back, how was the guy who came back different? How were you different when you came back?
Oh, I don't know. I was relieved back in the U.S. of A. You never know how much you love your country until you get over there and can't get back.
At the age you are now, with the life experience you have now, when you look back on that kid that went over there, what's your sense of it now? What do you think about?
Well, he was kind of stupid. And the young guy that went over there, he really didn't know what was going on, naturally. I mean, I'd been a farm boy in West Texas. I really didn't know anything about war or the war machines or how dangerous it was to get shot at. What I found out. But yeah, it's just, you're all young and you're not very bright.
And when you look back at your time in service, are you proud of that time?
Oh, you bet. Very, very proud. I had a young man ask me a couple of years ago. He said, "You know," said, "my dad never would talk about it." He said, "You talk freely about it." I said, "Well, young man," and I remember this too, that after the war was over, for the first 4 or 5 years, I never talked about it. Then I joined the American Legion, I joined the military Order of the Purple Heart, and all of these guys together, and they start discussing their war stories. And now I talk freely about my time in the service. And yes, I enjoyed the time in the service.